listening to Rootbound, a podcast about plants for when you're stuck inside.
This episode is sponsored by Black Pepper. Do you want to live like a king? Then buy some black pepper! Because, you know, back when there were a bunch of kings, it was really expensive and stuff.
Greetings, listeners. Thank you for listening to this episode of Rootbound. I'm the host of the show, and my name is Steve. And Rootbound is the podcast about plants for when you're stuck inside. And each week, I invite a guest who joins me on the show to share with us all about a plant that means something to them. And then I share with the guest about a plant that means something to me. And through this process, we can all learn more about plants and learn more about each other. It is the philosophy of this show that everybody has at least one plant that is meaningful to them, because plants are so integral to our lives as humans on this planet. We have another musician as a guest on the show today. I really like talking with musicians about plants, and I was thinking about why that is. Like, why do musicians often have very unique perspectives on plants? And I think it's because when you're writing music, it's this process of poetry, really. You know, writing music, writing poetry is very similar. And that contemplation of things, I think, leads you to an interesting place. And I was Googling around and trying to, like, think of how I could encompass this thought of, like, why is it really interesting to talk to musicians about plants? And I found this quote from Rachel Carson in the really famous book Silent Spring, which was kind of one of the first quintessential environmentalist books. And this quote from Silent Spring says, "Those who contemplate the beauty of the earth find reserves of strength that will endure as long as life lasts. There is something infinitely healing in the repeated refrains of nature, the assurance that dawn comes after night and spring after winter." Let's meet our guest, but before we do, let's hear a little bit of her music. Here is Fruit is Year 3 by Honeycrush. Hi, Honeycrush. Thank you for joining me on this episode of Rootbound.
Hi, it's nice to be here.
Do you have a plant to share with us today?
I do. My plant that I chose is baby's breath.
Very cool. I think the only thing I know about baby's breath is that it like appears sporadically in bouquets.
Yeah, exactly. I think the reason, I guess maybe if I can go into a little bit why I chose it.
Yeah, please.
Because I don't really know much about plants, so I'll be taking my time explaining it.
Sure.
Baby's breath to me is one of those plants that is, you grow up seeing it in floral arrangements, or it's, you know, like just kind of discarded because it's so ubiquitous. And I kind of just started seeing it as its own plant. It's kind of like when you start to see weeds, not as something that you need to get rid of, but as something that is just a plant like any other plant, and it's a weed because humans decided it's unpleasant or whatever. So I guess
if you've been listening to the show, that's like,
no,
totally what we talk about on the show. We say that on the podcast all the time. You're like right in our wheelhouse.
You know, what's funny is like, I previewed, you know, just kind of like peeked around at what the episodes, like the titles were, but I like to be surprised. And so I didn't want to listen to anything.
You're right on the ball. Sorry to interrupt you. I was like,
yeah, no, that's all good.
Yeah.
So I liked that. It's something that it made me look at it in a different way. And then, you know, I'm a huge Nirvana fan. So there's a Nirvana line in, I think it's Heart-Shaped Box. And he says, "Cut myself on angel's hair and baby's breath." And so
it
always kind of like resonated with me. And So I recently got some tattoos of baby's breath. And so when you asked me to choose a plant, it seemed like kind of a natural choice for me right now.
That's so cool. I totally forgot about that line. I'm definitely gonna play a clip of that after this segment. Okay, I don't know if I've ever seen it as a plant anywhere. What can you tell us about the plant itself?
Okay, so this is what I learned. It is called gypsophilia, and that's
Okay.
its technical name. I guess if you break that down, the gyps is part from gypsum, which would be like the mineral gypsum, and then philia is Greek for love, or madness, or however you want to define that. But it's I guess it grows mostly in like gypsum-rich locations. And it's part of the carnation family, which I thought was a really cool fact because it actually does look like tiny little clusters of carnations if you look at it really closely.
I just Googled a picture and I don't think I've ever looked at it that closely, but the macro shot, you would be like, oh, those are carnations, but it's actually the little tiny
And
things.
there's
That's cute.
something really special and delicate about it. And I think, again, thinking of it in terms of like it's just a misunderstood plant or something that made me look at it and think, wow, individually, each one of these things is very beautiful. And it's not just this like overly abundant throwaway, addition to a floral arrangement. So
Very
that's what I
cool.
brought today.
Very cool. So you're saying you're seeing it as a plant. Were you seeing it growing in places, or are we just like seeing it in a more like,
You
where
know,
have you
it
encountered
does
it?
grow in nature. I don't think, I know this isn't it, but like I'm from South Florida, and so like the plant life that we had is very different than the general understanding of what that plant life is. And just to give you an example, like the grass that I knew is, I guess, considered crab grass, because grass in Florida, at least where I'm from in South Florida, is super sharp and not fun to roll around in. And then in the north, it's soft. And my mom's from Ohio, and so we would like vacation, not vacation, but like go visit family up there. And I'd be just like, what is this? Is this what grass is, or is what Florida has grass? And so similar to that, we had these little things that I used to think were dandelions, but they're some kind of weed, and they kind of look like a baby's breath, where they have almost like a pinkish whitish bud center. And I would pick them and try to blow them, but they're definitely not dandelions, and they don't do that. So I don't think I've seen it growing in nature, but there is this, I think that it has like 150 different species. And
Oh, wow.
there are a lot of different variations of it. So it could be something that we do see that we don't even really register as the type of baby's breath that we usually see in like floral arrangements or, prom updos.
Totally. So I don't know if you have an answer to this, but I'm just going to like speculate a little bit, and the audience can Google it if we don't have it. But I'm just thinking about there must be like a growing, like an industry where people grow this
It has
for
to be.
floral arrangements, right?
I would assume. It's just everywhere.
So I wonder what that's like, because I talked about this plant a few episodes ago, another plant a few episodes ago, which also pops up in floral arrangements a ton, and its supply chain was really surprising. It's a plant that in Guatemala where it's harvested called shate, but it's the little like palm leaves that are in the back of a
Oh,
floral
yeah.
arrangement.
Yeah.
And that stuff is harvested in the wild in Latin America and then
Yeah.
imported to the United States for floral arrangements. So I was very surprised when I learned that that was like a wild harvested plant.
Yeah.
I don't think baby breath is probably like that, but I bet you there's an interesting supply chain story
I
about it
should have
too.
looked further because it very well might be.
Yeah, I'll do a little Googling, maybe tag something on the end here about that. But that's super interesting. Do you where is your tattoo, if you don't mind me asking?
Oh, I actually got matching ones. I know the audience can't see them. Wait, that's the wrong
Yeah, sure.
side. But I got them on my forearms. It's kind of hard
Oh,
to show
cool.
the camera, but they're on
Yeah,
both
yeah.
sides.
Oh, cool.
So I feel like I'm
Very
carrying
prominent
them
during
with
guitar
me.
playing, huh?
Yeah. I kind of feel like I'm carrying flowers all the time now.
That's very cool. I mean, maybe off baby's breath a little bit, because you brought up Florida and the different kind of plants down there. I feel like I haven't spent a ton of time in Florida, but it's kind of like a whole different world plant life wise. I wonder if that kind of, like, being from Florida, what that's like as far as your relationship with plants.
You know, what's funny is I think I've always been, I've always had a sort of a lot of romantic notions about plants and the outside. Like, I would want to spend a lot of time outside, or want to, you know, imagine like sleeping on a lawn chair in a garden or something, you know, and that is stuff you absolutely cannot do out there. You'll get eaten alive by mosquitoes, and there are lizards everywhere. And so even now, like, I'll see people with like deck furniture or something and think about how wild it is in Florida. How, like, growing up with the thinking that everything there was quote unquote like normal, as in what it is everywhere else, and then like becoming an adult and living other places and realizing, wow, no, you could probably do that in California, you could never do that in Florida. I'm still amazed, you know, I'm in New York, I'm still amazed that I don't see like lizards everywhere. And yeah, I mean, it's like mostly you're planting into sand. There isn't soil, it's sand. So, you know, but my mom planted a lot of different flowers. We had roses, we had hibiscus, and I had an arbor that had a trellis, I guess it's called. And it had bougainvillea, and that's always any kind of like climbing vining plant was always just a big favorite of mine. But yeah, I have a lot of memories of outside where I had like a different version of what outside really was in my head.
Yeah, that's interesting to think about. I think I've had that reflection of being in Florida a few times, and just all the wildlife that seems so tropical and exotic to people who live in other places. Yeah. In the US. And then there's the whole alligator thing, which is, you know, like,
they're everywhere.
They're just everywhere. Like any body of water. I was like,
I've seen them in like planned communities I'd lived in all the time. Mm-hmm. And you know, they're everywhere.
Very interesting. Yeah. It's like growing up in a place where there literally are monsters.
Yeah.
That's so fascinating. Okay. Before we switch topics, I was just thinking a little bit, going back to when you were talking about why you choose baby's breath. And I'm wondering about that moment when you started to see baby's breath as a plant. Can you talk about that, or some moments where you saw it and were thinking about it in that way?
I think it's a slow process that probably not just mirrored, but like was a part of this growth that I have been doing over the past few years, just as a human, you know, becoming more aware of everything on earth, you know, as you age, and you can age and just get old, but you can also age and like really try to understand what that means to you, and try to understand in the context of the world. And, you know, I think I've always really taken an interest in things, but as I've gotten older, I think it's just gotten more so. And I just like to separate things from the typical context that you see them in to be able to really understand them better. It's stupid, but I do it with clothes in my closet. Sometimes if you hang all your clothes in your closet the same way all the time, a lot of times I realize I don't want to wear anything because I'm kind of just sick of the order that they're in. And when I like move them around, or if I take something out and I really, really look at it, it gives me just this totally different appreciation for it, and actually see little features of it differently. And so that's kind of like a roundabout way of saying, I think I just came upon baby's breath because as I've gotten older, I've just learned to appreciate things differently. Mm-hmm. And
that fits into actually two running themes of the show. One is something coined by my friend. Audience of the show will know what I'm about to say, because I say it all the time, but it's so true. Every time I have a guest, it comes up. A friend of mine on a number of episodes ago, he said out of nowhere, botany comes with age.
Totally. I mean, that's what they say also about like get a garden, you know, like gardening keeps you young. I definitely understand that.
And then the other thing is, I've talked about this concept, which I learned a few episodes ago, which comes up all the time now. It's this concept of plant awareness disparity, and it's the idea that people mostly in our, you know, in our culture and a lot of cultures tend to see plants as just things in the background and not mm-hmm. as like individual life living beings, but you can switch that, right? Mm-hmm. If you start, and then, and it's kind of a whole new way of looking at the world.
Yeah.
Once you stop thinking of them as just like background.
Yeah, totally. And that's also something I think about with flowers. I would think all the time, like, oh, I'm so enraptured by flowers. And I would think, God, that's such a boring thing to like, you know, images of flowers because they're just everywhere. And then I had I ended up having a conversation, I think, one day with my friend Mark Malman, who's a musician, and we met through TikTok, and we chat a lot about interesting life things and cool stuff like that. But we were talking about how special flowers are and how unique each one of them is. And again, it's the same thing. You just, we're kind of inundated with this idea that they're everywhere, so they must be boring, but they're so special.
Yeah, it's like a kind of like, oh, it's like cliche to like flowers, but no, actually flowers
exactly,
are awesome.
Exactly. It feels like a cliche and it's just boring. Yeah. And you know, I was talking about getting tattoos and I like to get tattoos more so recently. And a lot of times I'm like, what am I going to get besides flowers again? So have to like really dig into like a reason for something to help me come out of just, well, I want some beautiful roses.
Yeah, it's, I mean, they're beautiful and they're cool and they're beautiful on purpose, right? They're beautiful to attract insects and they're beautiful in some ways to attract us.
Yeah,
and, it's really amazing. Yeah,
yeah, it's really special. I think everything in the world, you know, everything that we do as humans to replicate some kind of beauty is just trying to match nature, and it's incredible just how splendid nature really is.
Well, very good. Thank you so much for sharing about baby's breath with me. Do you mind if I share a plant with you?
Please. Yeah.
Okay.
What am I going to learn?
So this is a pretty interesting one. Well, yeah, this is one of those ones that maybe people would say is not interesting because it's kind of thought of as a
it's
weed.
A good theme.
It's something that you, something that you probably completely ignored walking by it, but it is kind of everywhere. I have some of it right here. This, I mean, the audience can't see this, but I'm showing it to, showing it to you here. So this is it. It's got these it's like kind of long and stringy, and it gets even longer than this, and it can like twirl around. If you can see up at the edge, it's got these little tendrils at the top it climbs on things. But audience, you'll be able to see pictures in the show notes and stuff. I'll stop vamping here and say what it's called. So this plant is called common vetch, which is kind of a weird name. It's V-E-T-C-H, vetch. And it is everywhere, and its history is really fascinating, and what it does is really fascinating, and I learned some even new things about it today. So let's talk about this stuff. Vetches are like super common. There's a lot of vetches. This is called common vetch because it, I guess, is the most common, and it's been used for centuries and centuries for mostly, from my understanding, as animal fodder. So it's a really good, nutritious plant for animals to eat. But its scientific name is Vicia sativa. Sativa just means cultivated, and Vicia is what it's called, and that's where the word vetch comes from. Vicia, and I love etymology.
Vetch.
I love looking up etymology.
It's very casual.
Totally. It's kind of a weird word to say all the time. Vetch, you know, it's like, I kept thinking of like puns of like, you know, I got 99 problems, but a vetch ate one, stuff like that. When I was like reading about it, but, the word vicia in Latin is probably connected to some words that mean, to curve or to bind. And it does that with the way that it works. So, and then almost every like European language has some weird combination of vici or vetch. It's been called that for a very long time. So it is in the Fabaceae family of plants, and that is the bean or legume family.
Oh.
Yeah.
How does it grow?
And so those tendrils, Huh?
How does it grow? Like in a bush or
from it grows, it tends to like crawl around the ground like really low, but if it finds something it can crawl up, but it doesn't crawl up too high. Mm-hmm. And those tendrils do help it pull onto things, and it gets really like messy and like tangled. Mm-hmm. At least where it's growing, where I see it in my yard. I pulled this from my yard. And it's growing as a weed in my yard. It's native to Europe and Asia, but it was brought over here around the time of the Revolutionary War for animal fodder. Mm-hmm. And then it's kind of become a weed. But, you know, like I said, the definition of weed is tricky.
Mm-hmm. Those tendrils are very pretty.
Yeah, they really,
they're all curved.
And then the other thing about it, which it's too early to show you this now, but it does have these beautiful little purple flowers that kind of look like pea flowers because peas are in the same family.
Yeah.
But they cover the whole thing, but they're much smaller than pea flowers.
Mm-hmm. So pretty.
So a couple other things in the Vicia genus, which I was surprised to learn about. One is Vicia lens, which is the common lentil, is in the same genus as this plant.
Love some lentil soup.
Yeah. And then also Vicia faba is the faba bean, which is the biggest one in this.
Yeah.
In this, but in the same genus. So that gets into, which I didn't realize until I was researching this episode, is the edibility of this plant, which it is edible with a catch, but the catch actually applies to the other two I talked about as well, which is super, super fascinating. So I guess this one you can actually cook and eat the greens. I'm going to do a little bit extra research before I do that. And also, I'm not 100% sure that this is common vetch. This could be one or two others. There's just a ton of them, and I have to kind of wait for the flower. I have to kind of wait for the flowers to come in to be sure what it is. But from my eyes, I understand if you were to eat just a little bit of this, you probably wouldn't die. Mm-hmm. But like, you know, I always tell the audience, be careful. I do like eating wild plants. It's like one of the things I do on this
so
podcast.
Cool. I would love to do that.
Yeah, you've got a lot of cool opportunities in Brooklyn, by the way. Prospect Park's got some good foraging. I know some people out there.
That's cool. Yeah. I got to go check that out.
A lot of beans have this chemical in them. And so when this flowers and it turns and the flower turns into the fruit looks like little miniature bean pods. They're they're really small.
Oh, and they, I feel like you see that everywhere. You see like a bean pod type thing on a tree or something. Yeah.
Yeah, and they'll be around. You'll see them. They're really, really small. And then they dry, and you kind of can get five almost like lentil-sized hard beans from it. But most beans, and particularly the one you'll read about a lot is kidney beans are like this. But most beans, this is true, is that you can't eat them raw. They have this chemical in them called lectin. That if you eat it raw, it will make you sick. And so you need to cook beans thoroughly. And so one of the things when you're reading about this online, they're like, oh, well, if you eat it, it's toxic. But I think the thing is, well, you just got to cook it.
Which
people get nervous about plants that have toxins in them, but people don't get nervous that you have to cook chicken, right? Like sometimes you just have to cook,
true.
Right?
That's true.
Right? But this is where it gets super fascinating. This kind of like this chain of events here. So lectin... What it does is it binds to carbohydrates. So it binds to sugars. And so it can end up binding to the sugars on the outside of your red blood cells in your stomach lining. And that can make you feel really sick. And, you know, if you eat a ton of it, it can be really bad because of the way it binds to those chemicals. But the reason it does that is because of this really fascinating concept that is common to, I think, the entire Fabaceae family, which is the concept of nitrogen-fixing bacteria in root nodules. This is like super scientific, but it is amazing. Okay, let me see if I can do this quickly. This is my challenges podcast, is how to like condense these like super scientific things into like something, a thing. So most of the air we breathe is nitrogen. The vast majority of the atmosphere is nitrogen. But we don't need nitrogen to breathe. Well, we don't need it to breathe. We do need it in other ways. But the thing is, the nitrogen in the air is in this form of N2, so they're two nitrogen molecules bonded with a triple bond, which means nothing can happen with them. They're basically chemically inert. So there's just all this nitrogen everywhere, but it's not accessible to life. But life needs nitrogen. So there's the problem, right? How do living things get nitrogen? And there's a few different ways, but one of the big ways is these really magical little bacteria that have the ability to break that nitrogen apart and turn it into something that is usable by plants. And those bacteria form a symbiosis with the plant, and they work together. So the plant gives the bacteria the sugars it creates through photosynthesis, and the bacteria give the plant the nitrogen it needs to make its other stuff. And then we eat the plants, and then we get the nitrogen we need. Mm-hmm. Really beautiful. But that lectin, basically the plants send out some certain flavonoids that attract the bacteria, and that lectin, because it can bond to carbohydrates, bonds to a carbohydrate on the bacteria, and so they form this like fusion, and then the plant grows around the bacteria. And when you look at the roots of a plant that have these bacteria, they have these little nodules, these little like balls, where the basically it's like a little special home for the bacteria made by the plant, which is just really amazing. And so the bean family is really, really important because it's one of the few plant families that can actually enrich the soil with nitrogen. Most plants extract nitrogen from the soil, and you have to somehow get it back with compost or natural decay or things like that. But beans can fix nitrogen in the soil. And so vetch was a super, super important plant and still is, because you can grow it in the field. Your animals can eat it, but it also does not deplete the soil. So, very cool plant.
Yeah.
That you, yeah.
Good find. How do you, I'm curious, how do you find a plant in your yard and then figure out what it is?
Okay, I have a few methods. The main thing is there's some really awesome apps out there now. There's one called Seek, one called Picture This, and they use artificial intelligence to like, you know, take a picture of it. And it's amazing. Like, I don't know if you have one of those.
No, but my friend will maintain that she invented this from over a decade ago.
It's amazing. So yeah, if she invented it, she definitely needs big props. It's amazing that it works so well. You have to be a little careful. So especially before I decide to eat anything.
Right, yeah.
I try to check with a few different sources by looking online. I also, a really good thing to do, and I've done this a few times, is you know, like connect with a local foraging expert, and like there's a guy in town who does like classes, and you walk around and he shows stuff, so you learn from an expert as well. And so, you know, eventually you can identify it. The vetch is a little tricky because they look pretty similar, but there's other plants that they look, it's hard to mix them up. So this is one that has been in my yard for a number of years. I've known about it, but I haven't really paid that much attention until I decided to talk about it on this episode.
Cool. Thank you for telling me about it.
Yeah, there you go. Now you know about common fetch. So, hey, Honeycrest, do you mind sticking around for the final segment of the show?
Yeah, sure. Of course.
This is Milk Teeth by Honeycrest. Let's give it a listen, and then we'll check back in with her after the song is over.
Thank you.
Milk Teeth by Honeycrush. Okay, so earlier, before we started speaking with Honeycrush, we heard a little clip from her song called Fruit is Year 3. And that's like one of the things that maybe was like, hey, I should have her on the podcast because she's got a song about fruit. And I was imagining what it was about. And I'm a little bit bummed that I read this because I kind of think I understand the meaning of the song now better. But I'm going to let you explain it in a second. But my first thought was when I heard Fruit is Year 3, I was thinking about as a gardener, when you plant trees, they often don't fruit until year 3.
Oh, that's so
like, or sometimes
cool.
Later, sometimes later, but like 3 years is kind of like, wow, the minimum before you think you can get fruit from a tree, wow, like a plum or a
yeah,
so,
yeah.
And so that's what I thought it was. And then I read some little review about it, and that's not the case. So I was wondering if you want to explain to the audience what the meaning of fruit is your three.
Yeah. Wow. Well, I love knowing that kind of coincidental other meaning because, that has its own, you know, kind of like gravity, I think. But, the title of the song, Fruit is Year 3, is a reference to, I was at a party over the summer, and it was, I think it was an anniversary party, and the people were, they had been married for 3 or 4 years, and everyone was talking about what the traditional gifts are for certain years. The first year is like paper, the second year is wood or something, but they got to the year, the third or the fourth year, and they said that it was fruit. And I just thought that that was so bizarre as an omen or as something traditionally to almost wish on people that their love was going to be something that could rot, you know, it just doesn't seem like anything that you can keep for a long time. So that kind of wormed its way into my head as I was writing this EP of 3 songs. And they were all to do with sort of like the frailty of love or the maybe the culpability that you have in the dissolution of your own love, just kind of like an alternate perspective, I think, of love. And I was also writing this in December, and it was very dark and very rainy, and I was just like alone in my apartment and writing and recording, and I did that in a matter of just a couple of days. So these were all jam-packed with a lot of emotion. So that's what the song is actually about. It's about this like the end of something before it's even started, really.
Yeah, interesting that paper definitely lasts longer than fruit.
I know, it's like they just put a bunch of things in a hat.
And it really is. I mean, is. You know. My wife is really bummed that I didn't get her paper for her.
Yeah, exactly. it's like I forgot all those things existed until that conversation happened, honestly.
Yeah, it's kind of a weird thing. There's probably a podcast somewhere that goes into the details about why this exists. Okay, the last thing I want to talk to you about, which is I think another reason why I had you on the show, and this is only tangentially plant related, but you know the name of your project, Honeycrush, stood out to me for a particular reason, and I'll explain that. But I'm curious about why you chose that name, and it probably has nothing to do with why it's interesting to me. But I'm curious about that.
I think that a lot of things I like have multiple meanings or have multiple imagery, you know, that comes along with them. And I've always had a certain attraction to honey as an idea, as a real thing, the flavor of it, the way it moves, and then crush, the same thing. As far as the word goes, I've always loved that word and what it depicts and how you can have a crush and be crushed and crush something because you love it or crush it because you hate it. And I think just those two things together kind of gave me the sense that this is the way I am. You know, we're all very like a lot of things going on with us. There's so many contradictions within me and you. And then this also kind of defines this sound that I think I have, which is a little bit rough and a little bit soft, and I can never really figure out which one it's more of. So it just seemed to be the perfect balance and the perfect smash of everything all together.
Okay, that makes a lot of sense and it's super interesting. So the reason why your name stood out to me is because I'm a beekeeper.
Oh, okay.
I'm actually a beekeeper. I don't have bees right now. My wife and I had a kid recently, and having a hobby like that is going to be on the back burner for a few years. Yeah. But I still call myself a beekeeper. I've done it a number of years. Mm-hmm. I'm really into it. And there actually is a thing called, well, It's actually technically called the Crushin strain, but it is actually a honey crush.
Oh, that's the beekeepers so cool.
Do. Yeah. So there's a way. Yeah. So there's a couple different ways you can extract honey from the honeycomb. And the more old school way is you basically take out all the honeycomb and you crush it and
so
the honey
crazy.
Comes out and then you strain the wax from the, from the honey.
That's amazing.
And in recent years, I used to have the more modern way, which is like this centrifugal extractor and you like spin it really fast and the honey flies out into the sides
cool.
and
yeah,
drips
yeah.
down. And that's good because the bees can reuse the wax and it's a little bit less resource intensive. But in the last few years, I've not been harvesting as much honey and I've only been taking one or two frames because they can get a lot of honey from one or two honey frames. Mm-hmm. And for me, the crush method was actually preferred because it wasn't as much. I've been doing a lot of more crush and strain is what beekeepers call it. But for now, I think I'm going to call it the honey crush.
Honey crush. Yeah. That's such a nice coincidence.
My guest on this episode of Root Bound was Honey Crush. Honey Crush is a singer-songwriter based in New York. Check out her music in all the normal places you listen to music. There will also be links in the show notes. If you like this show and you want to help support it, visit rootboundpodcast.com/support to find all the ways that you can help support the show, including supporting the show on Patreon. Root Bound is hosted by Steve Ellington, who will not stop trying to make vetch happen. Music by Christian Krigaskota. Fake ads by David Lani. Rootbound is a podcast about plants for when you're stuck inside, but if you can go outside, pick some fruit for someone you love. I think it actually is a pretty great gift.
Black pepper! It used to be, like, really expensive!